Welcome to Vineyard Boise. It's our vision to make the invisible God visible wherever He places us. We come together on Sundays to worship and fellowship corporately. But we know that church isn't just about Sunday. It's about a lifelong, day-to-day following of Christ with other believers. We invite you to join us, just as you are. If you'd like to support our ministry, visit vineyardboise.org and click the Give Online button.
Cool. Tell you what, it's a wonderful school. Wonderful group of people. Might be a great fit for you. Kind of best of both worlds. Best of, it's kind of a hybrid of a private Christian school and also homeschool. Really pretty powerful model. So check that out tomorrow night. If we could get our ushers and greeters to come, we're going to receive our morning offering. And I don't want to spend too much time talking because we got some special stuff going on this morning. And so I just want to jump into prayer. Would you just join me in... Let's take a posture of being open to God's Spirit. You know, throughout church history, it's part of the Vineyard's legacy, but it's really a part of church history, is that the simple prayer, come Holy Spirit, and just inviting God to do what He wants to do. So let's be open to Him this morning. Lord Jesus, You promised Your disciples that You would send the Holy Spirit, that You would ask the Father and He would pour out the Spirit without measure. And Heavenly Father, I am confident that is our greatest need, is for fresh encounters of Your presence, that You would fill us, envelop us, saturate us. Lord, that You would give us eyes to see You in a world where there is so much fear, where there is so much anger. Lord, that we would have eyes to see our circumstances, our personal circumstances, and the circumstances of our nation and world through eyes of faith of what You could do. Lord, we are simply an ordinary people with an extraordinary God, and we need eyes to see You. And so we do, we stand with the saints throughout the generations, and we say, come Holy Spirit. We are open to Your presence. We're open to every manifestation of Your presence in our midst today. Everything that would come from Your hand, everything that would come from Your mouth. We welcome You and we trust You. Heavenly Father, we rarely know the plans You have for us. But we know the person that we're called to follow. And You are altogether good. And Your plans are good. And so, in faith, we give You an unqualified yes to the things You want to do both in us and through us. But let it begin in us, though, so that we're not out there doing Your work apart from a vital life with You, that we're being transformed into Your image, that You are becoming greater in our eyes. So we welcome You. And as we give of our tithes and offerings, Lord, we do so trusting that You've called us to live in a kingdom economy. And so, Lord, would You help us to be both generous and faithful? Would You increase our capacity to give, our capacity to be generous? And would You entrust us with more resources to the degree that we can use for Your glory? Lord, we will seek Your kingdom and trust You to meet our needs. As a church, as a body, and also as individual members of this body. Help us to seek first Your kingdom. And would You add all the things to us that we need? Amen. Well, as those baskets are going around, I'm just going to jump in. We're studying Numbers 13. Well, we're in the book of Numbers right now. And this is a year, 2017 is a year that we believe that God has called us to go as a church, to take a posture as a church reaching out into our community, but also as individuals reaching out to the people amongst whom we live, in our workplaces, our neighborhoods, our homes, our family, our friendships, that we would take a posture of going. We believe that God has called us to go. He hasn't given us a plan for the whole year that's all mapped out. He's just said, take a posture of going, and I will give you what you need as you go. It's the same thing that God gave to to Moses when he called him to lead the people out of slavery in Egypt. He said, go and I will be with your voice and I will teach you what you should speak. But Moses had to step out in faith first. He had to step out and then God met him as he stepped out. That's the life of faith. It's a life of cultivating a listening ear to the Spirit of the living God and then following what he says. So we believe that that's what the call that God has on us. And so, you know, as we're studying through Numbers, it's interesting because Numbers is a people that are also called to go. And Numbers is a sobering book because we find a generation of people who had a tremendous call of God in their lives. And God was faithful. Though these people abandoned God, God did not abandon them. And so God still saw them through to the end of their lives, but they never got to walk in the fullness and the abundance and the joy and the pleasure that God had for them because they got sidelined by unbelief. And so I think there's a powerful lesson for us here as we study through this. We're going to be in chapter 13 and 14 today, and here's what I believe. I believe that God has called us, each one of us. This is collective and it's individual. He's called us that this year would be a year of greater risk, of greater trust, of greater obedience, and because of that, greater fruit. That we would get to see the joy of Garden City being transformed and the lives around us being transformed by the power of the living God. The call that God has on us is not a geographical call to take more land. It's not geographical like it was in the story we're reading. It's biographical. God has called us to make more disciples of him, to introduce people to the living God, the loving God, and to help them grow as disciples, as we all grow as disciples. So we pick up on our story. It's in Numbers 13. This is the generation that was called out of Egypt, and they're on the brink of the promised land. As we resume the story, here's a map. They've moved from the place we saw them at last week, and now they're at Kadesh Barnea. If you follow the arrow up to the middle of the Sinai Peninsula there, they're at Kadesh Barnea. That's where this is all going to be staged, which is basically it's the staging area for their advance into the promised land. And so here's a generation of people who are getting to walk in the promises that God has promised to their family going back over 600 years. This is the land that God told Abraham, go and walk in this land and I will give it to your descendants after you. And so finally the generation has arrived that's getting to walk in those promises. Here's what happens. The Lord spoke to Moses saying, send men to spy out the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the people of Israel. From each tribe of their fathers, you shall send a man, every one a chief among them. So Moses sent them from the wilderness of Paran, according to the command of the Lord, all of them men who were heads of the people of Israel. Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan, and he said to them, go up into the Negev and into the hill country and see what the land is, and whether the people who dwell in it are strong or weak, whether they are few or many, and whether the land that they dwell in is good or bad, and whether the cities that they dwell in are camps or strongholds, and whether the land is rich or poor, and whether there are trees in it or not. You like trees? Be of good courage and bring some of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the season of the first ripe grapes. At the end of 40 days, they returned from spying out the land. They came to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of the people of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh. They brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told him, we came to the land to which you sent us. It flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. However, the people who dwell in the land are strong, and the cities are fortified and very large. And besides, we saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the Negev, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites dwell in the hill country, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and along the Jordan. But Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and occupy it, for we are well able to overcome it. Then the men who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we are. So they brought to the people of Israel a bad report of the land that they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone to spy out is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people that we saw in it are of great height. And there we saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak, who come from the Nephilim, and we seemed to ourselves like grasshoppers, and so we seem to them. Then all the congregation raised a loud cry, and the people wept that night. And all the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, "Would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become a prey. Would it not be better for us to go back to Egypt?" And they said to one another, "Let us choose a leader and go back to Egypt." And Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the people of Israel. And Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes. And they said to all the congregation of the people of Israel, "The land which we passed through to spy out is an exceedingly good land. And if the Lord delights in us, he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land that flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord. Do not fear the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their protection is removed from them. The Lord is with us. Do not fear them." Then all the congregation said to stone them with stones. But the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting to all the people of Israel. And the Lord said to Moses, "How long will this people despise me? How long will they not believe in me, in spite of all the signs that I have done among them? I will strike them with the pestilence and disinherit them, and I will make of you a great nation, mightier than they." But Moses said to the Lord, "Then the Egyptians will hear of it, for you brought up this people in your might from among them, and they will tell of the inhabitants of this land. They have heard that you, O Lord, are in the midst of this people, for you, O Lord, are seen face to face. Your cloud stands over them. You go before them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Now, if you kill this people as one man, then the nations who have heard your fame will say, 'It is because the Lord is not able to bring this people into the land that he swore to give to them, that he has killed them in the wilderness.' Now, please, let the power of the Lord be great, as you have promised, saying, 'The Lord is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, forgiving iniquity and transgression. But he will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation. Please pardon the iniquity of this people, according to the greatness of your steadfast love, just as you have forgiven this people from Egypt until now.' Then the Lord said, 'I have pardoned according to your word, but truly as I live, and as all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord, none of the men who have seen my glory and my signs that I did in Egypt and in the wilderness, and yet have put me to the test these 10 times and have not obeyed my voice, none of them shall see the land that I swore to give to their fathers. None of those who despised me shall see it. But my servant Caleb, because he has a different spirit and has followed me fully, I will bring into the land into which he went, and his descendants shall possess it. Now, since the Amalekites and the Canaanites dwell in the valleys, turn tomorrow and set out for the wilderness by the way of the Red Sea." This is God's word. That's a sobering word, isn't it? This is a story involves 2 generations of God's people. 1 generation that refused to walk in the things that God had for them. And so God was still faithful, but they never got to experience the abundance of what he intended them for. The sobering thing to think that we as Christians can live lives, either lives that are full of God's goodness and his abundance and see his plans walked out in our lives, that we can experience that kind of joy, or we can get sidelined and we can live lives of just unbelief and failure and defeat. I've been studying this week, and I've been sobered by the fact that it's an indictment of the leadership, because these 12 men, the 12 spies, there was one leader from each tribe that was sent. And so this is a leadership failure. And you see that the entire congregation was infected by bad leadership. And there's a contrast here, because you've got 2 leaders who speak faith and belief, and they say, yes, it's a great land, and yes, there's big people, but God can do it. And then you see there's 10 that say, no, God can't do it. And the whole congregation follows them. Studying this week, and honestly, I came up with probably 6 different messages. Because there's a lot going on in here, and there's a lot of questions that this passage raises, and so I was all over the place, and so I blocked out Thursday morning, and I went off site to just try and spend some focused time just trying to narrow it down to, what do you want us to glean from this message this week? And I left that time of study not really with a full direction, but knowing that I think the thing that God has for us is to explore this life of unbelief versus faith. Here's the thing. Of these 12 men and the entire congregation, all of them had seen the same signs in God, that God had done. This whole generation had been led out of Egypt. They'd all seen God lead them out of Egypt by a strong and mighty arm, you know, leading them out of Pharaoh with the 10 plagues. They'd seen God's hand at the Red Sea opening up the sea and them walking across on dry land. They'd all experienced the same thing. But only 2 of them were able to take that and to live lives in response to it. Only 2 of them lived lives. Only 2 of them were so affected by what they'd seen that they were able to say, I'm going to step out and risk and trust that God's going to continue to meet us. I believe if we're, as a church and as individual members of this body, if we're to walk in the things God has for us, it's going to involve us coming against walled cities, giants, maybe not physical giants, but circumstances that seem fortified, circumstances that seem to discourage, circumstances that would threaten to just rob our confidence. And we have a choice of faith versus unbelief. So I left that time with this question. This is the last question I wrote as I left that study time. God, what allows us to walk into an unknown future in a way that's pleasing to you? And make space to experience the fullness of your goodness and your plans and your pleasure. I came in to the office that afternoon because I just had to shift gears and set aside the study and prep time. I had some meetings here. And so one of those meetings was one that Angelia, my admin, had set up for me. I hadn't set it up, but it was with 2 ladies, with Esther and Sharon. And they had reached out to Angelia and said, we've been part of the Vineyard for about 6 months now, but we don't really know anybody yet. We'd like to just introduce ourselves and make ourselves known, so could we have an appointment with Pastor Trevor? And so Angelie had scheduled that for me. I came into it not knowing who I was going to meet, and so these 2 ladies came into my office, and I just, as they began to tell me who they are and share their story, I just fell in love with them. These are mature saints who have a lifelong story of walking with God and seeing him meet them, of stepping out in faith and seeing what God would do. Situations that would make others step back and say, no, that's not possible. And they've said, well, no, but it's possible with God. And so just meeting with them, my faith was stirred. Because, I love the stories in here, but the most recent ones are 2,000 years old. And they were on a different continent in a different language. And here I had these 2 ordinary people who'd lived life in response to an extraordinary God and got to see him do all kinds of things. A life of adventure, a life of risk. I think this is probably the key verse over their lives. It's this verse. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. Esther and Sharon have written a book about their lives. We have a few available in the bookstore. We'll have more next week. I suspect you may want one of these. This just tells the story of them stepping out in faith. It's their journey of what it looked like for them to say yes to Jesus. And it's a life of conversational friendship with God, of learning to discern what is God's voice and what is man's voice. And it's not a formula, it's a journey. But it's a journey where they have become greater friends with God and God has become bigger and bigger in their eyes. And they've been able to trust him with more and more things. So as I walked him out of the office, I was just stunned. I walked out of the office, followed him out, and as they walked across the parking lot, I said to Lori and Maureen, who I say most of my accidentally important things to, I said, there goes a modern-day Caleb and Joshua. They've lived lives of faith. And they've seen God move. So I ended up calling him Friday and saying, hey, would you guys come and just share with us? Just share some of your stories. Here's what I believe. The 10 spies brought back a story of unbelief, and it infected everyone. But in the same way that unbelief is infectious, so is faith. And there's an anointing that can be passed to others as we hear a life of faith and see what God would do. So would you welcome Esther and Sharon? Esther's story began of walking with God back in 1972. She's a school teacher in the Seattle area. She and Sharon met in 79, and they've been together ever since. I would encourage you to pick up one of these this week or next week, and after you read it, I'm about halfway through it already, and I'm a slow reader, but it's infectious. This is a book not to read and then put on your shelf. It's a book to read and then pass to somebody else because it inspires faith in God. So
we paid him to say that.
Okay. We're going to let her start. I get carried away and talk too much.
No, not too. But I asked her if I could start because the reason we are here is because of our neighbors. Esther and I have been a part of church ministries and leadership positions for many, many years, but we've never seen a congregation like this one that's trying to minister to body, soul, and spirit locally and internationally. And since we have a call to the world, we were so blessed to find a church that, even though we drive from Meridian, a church that's actually trying to do it on all those different levels. But it started with watching three of our neighbors drive down the street to come to this church. So I just want to put in the plug for the neighbor outreach. Please, please be listening today and be looking for ways you can be praying into your neighborhood and changing it.
Mm-hmm. I told some of the other folks, they would never hear the same story twice from us because we have far too many, so we just going to share one that I'm quite sure you haven't heard before. And it starts off when God took us from the land of plenty, which was Victoria, British Columbia. And not only did he let us stay there, but we ended up there 9 3/4 of a year. And we went down to get our visa renewed. And because we did not take any offerings, our government said we could come as one as we wanted, but all of a sudden they said no. You can't come. You can hardly call yourself first-timers here when you've been here for 9.5 years. That's
how much. I did say to Esther that there were ways to come into the country. We could give them $100,000, or no big deal, right? Esther could and I could swim ashore and be refugees. However, or we could come in and do housework, but they said, Esther, you have a PhD after your name. We don't think that you're going to get accepted as a domestic worker.
And so, after we'd been there for a long time and had many, many friends who prayed us around the world repeatedly when we were on our many journeys, I want to tell you a story that is very true. When, after we were rejected and told to go back to the United States, we had no idea what to do. My folks had a little house in Oregon, but the logging business had completely dropped out and the town was getting poorer and poorer and poorer. And would you believe it? I had begged my dad when he was still very active to sell the place, get rid of it. It was starting to become the dump of the city. It got worse. And he said to me one day before he passed away, you know, Esther, someday you may need this house. And I said, over my dead body, I'll be needing this house. So he let my body die for the next 20 years. I learned a lot of things in that place. But the first thing I learned was that everybody had a mental spirit of desperation and no jobs. The state of Oregon sent there are people that were released from prison to that little town because there was such cheap rent that poor people right out of prison would go there and live.
Our whole time there was hardly a family that we ever met that didn't have at least one relative that had jail or prison in their background.
And to tell you the deplorableness of that town is just nothing but the worst. And God has lived two doors from a family that were practicing incense with their children. People that were just so broken and so unloved and so unsure that we just could not even begin to comprehend how bad it was.
One of the key drug dealers in town was our next door neighbor. We shared a fence. We didn't know anything about pit bulls before we moved to that area.
But we became very acquainted.
Apparently, pit bull is the dog of choice of drug dealers. And so this dog had been known to break a, what was it?
Chain, that heavy chain.
85, I don't know, it was a heavy chain. He had done serious damage to one of the neighborhood boys. But we had a friend who was a prayer, and she took that on. And you can imitate his bark. How did he bark?
Woo, woo, woo.
It's not the kind of sound you like coming from the next door neighbor.
And she was this little sweetie pie, you know, about 99 pounds, and lived up in Canada. And we said, we really need help with this pit bull. And so she started to pray. And this is a gospel truth. That dog broke that chain, came over and just stood on our porch and just like, just try to come in here. And we weren't about to. It was that dangerous. But slowly but surely, one day we went out and there was the dog across there where he belonged, and he was going, whoop, whoop.
And the next
God
thing we
stopped
heard,
him from that horrible barking.
And the next thing we heard, he had mysteriously died.
He was gone. And she was the lady that taught us to pray for people around the world. When I first met her, she was at her Davenport on her knees, and her husband was at the Oregon bench on his knees, and I was there as a guest of theirs, and they prayed for an hour and a half while I stood there watching them in shock. I had been invited to come there and have nice dinner with them because I was going to stay there and do some ministry, and the one who was important was Jesus. And they covered every place. You couldn't imagine where they covered. After an hour and a half, they got up and said, oh, have you been here long? I said, maybe a little bit. But that's the kind of prayers they were.
So as near as we can tell, every one of us, if you're walking with Jesus, you're either a goer or a sender. Mm-hmm. And if you're a sender, chances are you're going to become a goer. And these people were incredible senders.
Yeah, they were. Anyhow, to get out of the misery we were in the Sweet Home Oregon, we would go uptown and walk around. It was nicer on the other side of the tracks by a whole lot.
One time we walked in the nice area where there was a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house for sale for $22,000. And we said, oh God, how about we move up there in one of those houses and then come down and minister in this area where we're living? And I had this flash of Jesus going to God and saying, hey, the earth is really crummy. Would you mind if I would just commute on weekends? And we know that didn't happen.
And so one of the things we would do, we'd go up around this church that my dad had helped build. And it was kind of half boarded up, and they were trying to sell it. Nobody would buy it, because they had built a nice new fancy one. And so as we walked around this thing, we'd pray, because they'd broken a window in it. And we said, Lord, whoever should have this, please give it to them. And one day, as clear as a bell, he said, why don't you buy it? I bet we hadn't received 5 cents since we'd been there. We were on the bottom of broke. But we weren't upset about that a bit. We just knew that it was terrible. And so we said, well, what would we do with it? And he said, what are you seeing all over here? Well, we're seeing single women with 3 kids almost every time. Husband couldn't stand the extra one, I guess, and they just blew the place. They had come in, there was 2 kids like this, but where's the third one? Was always trailing behind. It was desperate. They were desperate. Well, this was a big church, but it was completely run down. There was no way you could call it anything but gone. Every bathroom was brown from the toilets that were never fixed. And we started telling our friends around the world about it, and God started sending people. They came from Seattle. This was a six-hour trip. They came for three solid weekends and worked and worked and worked. Every time we'd have one thing done, it cost us $10,000 just to do the electrical update. The day we finished that.
This is the early 90s.
The day we finished that project, every penny of it was paid. We went to our pastors in this new church, this town, and the pastor was so scared of us, he went and got behind this pulpit and said, yes, what do you want? We said,
he was really welcoming.
He did that, really. Anyhow, we told him that it would be nice if some of the men would like to help us with some of the rebuilding. And it's a phenomenal story how God rebuilt that whole big 10,000 square foot chapel church
building, yeah.
And turned it into a living
shelter
for battered women and children. But more than that, you guys.
So this is a time when the logging industry, which is their main support, when we moved there, you couldn't wait 7 seconds without a logging truck, full logging truck coming through town. But everything just shut down. So the whole town was in crisis, and every pastor was so protective of every penny because they thought the kingdom of God ended outside the doors of their church. And so there were many churches in that town. None of them worked together, and there was certainly not an abundance of faith for projects. We could feel, when we would leave the city limits, we could feel the relief because of the heaviness of depression and poverty and just a poverty spirit. Not unlike where some of you live in this area.
I was just going to tell you that even the ceilings of this kind of stuff had to be recovered with special
every
stuff.
Every acoustic tile
so
had to be
you
painted.
Couldn't pass on the fire hazards.
Stuff, yeah.
And so we had thousands, and I think we probably had over 100,000 when we were through with it. Every penny was paid. We owed not one dime. Want to hear another part of the miracle?
Just
the
second,
pastor.
Are you telling
that,
about the tithing? That's
yeah,
why,
I'm going
okay.
to. The has-been pastor was so upset that I wanted to buy that building from him because he wouldn't give it to me. I tried first, the giving. That didn't work. So the next thing we said was, well, how much do we have to pay for it? Now, remember, this is a town you could buy for $100,000. And we're talking about a building that needed terrible repairs.
And a terrible parsonage next door.
Oh, yeah. And the five or six blocks.
Five city lots.
Yeah, and another house. And it was all ours. And we didn't want it all, but we got it all. Anyhow, that was 26 years ago. And we are now the only shelter in the state of Oregon that still has an active club where children and moms and dads, not dads, moms and three kids usually, sometimes four or five, are still going. It's the oldest running shelter in the state of Oregon. Hasn't missed a day. And I also want to tell you the truth. Sharon and I did not run it. We built it by the grace of God, but we turned it right over to people who had that kind of a heart of compassion, and we did not run it. Sometimes it's important to know that God gives you an assignment, but he doesn't mean you have to own it. You just do it, and then you go on your way and let God take care of it his way. And we have seen the faithfulness of the Lord over the years with that particular building.
And before it even came together, before it was even looking like a possibility, good friends of ours said, let us host some people to come together. So every Friday night, there were people from different churches that came to pray and just ask the Lord how he was going to do this. And so as soon as we began to kind of get established, Esther and I said, now one of the things we have learned as we've walked with the Lord is you have to keep giving back to God. There's no such thing as being the dead end of God's ministries. So here's the deal. Any money that comes in for this project, we called it Hope Center, helping our people in emergency, we're going to tithe. And well, there was a silence that came across the room because they said, well, we're in great need. We don't have any money. And and we should keep everything that comes. People are giving to us. And we said, no. That's not how God works. God keeps money moving. Everybody keeps giving, even though they are a ministry. So we lost a few board members
that night. And they were glad to have us gone, and we were glad to have them gone.
And every time some money would come in, like I remember the first $1,000, and people were so excited. We have $1,000. And so Esther and I said, so let's pray about where we're going to tithe. And they went, and so we prayed, and God showed us. And the next morning, the money that we had sent out was back in the coffers. It just, you know, you can't outgive God. But in that town and that poverty mentality, they were so shocked to see the money come back.
Yeah. So the reason I tell that is because you expect that poverty overseas. But, you know, America is so lost today. She's so lost. And I don't need to tell you all that. But you can do just as much ministry at home as you can on the fields. Now, Sharon and I have spent a multitude of our time on fields. But let me tell you, America's just as bad off. They need Jesus so bad. And if we don't get him back in here pretty soon, we'll be worse than the worst places that we work in.
Can I transition to China?
Absolutely.
Okay. While we were living in Canada and ministering from that as our base, China opened up. And so missionary friends of ours said, please, please pray for people to go minister in China. So Esther and I said, oh God, please send people to China to minister. And he spoke to my heart and he said, would you go to China? And I said, oh God, please send other people to China. And he kind of said, you know, when you pray the wrong thing and there's no answer? So I started to say, okay, Lord, you know that Esther's not going to go to English, teach English in China.
I had to take bonehead English in college, so you know I'm not that great.
So I said, who's going to go with me? And he said, Nancy. I said, what a great idea. She has a degree in English. Nancy was the pastor's wife.
Look
so
out.
I called up Nancy. I said, Nancy, would you go teach English with me in China? And she said, I can't do that. My husband's a pastor, and we've got an 8-year-old and a 10-year-old. I can't go to China. I said, would you at least pray about it? So Nancy said, okay. Nancy was a prayer warrior. She was a master in God's army. She said, so Lord, do you want me to go to China? And he said, yes. And she said, but I love Canada. And he said, you'll love it even more after you've been to China. So she came with me to China, and it changed her life. And it changed their whole family life because the father, who was always off at church meetings, was with the daughters. So the father, pastor, was our good friend, and he would joke, and he would come and say, now, Esther, I am never going to be a missionary, but if I ever am, you have to come and see me. So that was the deal. He's never going to be one, but if we'd have to come and see him. So after Nancy's summer in China, she was changed forever. And so was their whole family. So within less than 2 years, they were off to a year commitment to Kenya as a family. And it became the best year of their family's life. All four of their family members agreed it was the best year of their life. Yeah. Meanwhile, what does that do to the church when you take the head pastor off to Africa? Mm. Well, amazing things. God is so sovereign, he could take such good care of that church that they actually grew and flourished in body ministry when
without
the head pastor was gone.
Because
things, everybody stepped up. Mm-hmm. So then that meant we had to go to Africa because Esther's deal with Gordon.
Yeah.
But at that point, we were living in the slums of Oregon, and we were so excited to get to go to Africa and run away from America. And when I was 14, I was sharing in the first service that God had his hand on my life and said, I want you to give me your whole life. And I just resisted and resisted. Finally, at this church camp, on the last possible day, I went forward just to be relieved from that hand off my back. And then for the next 2 weeks, I couldn't sleep. God was going to make me go to Africa. I just knew it. And so 14 years old, I'm just scared to death I'm going to have to go to Africa. Life came around to such a place where we were just so grateful to get to go to Africa, to get out of the other stuff that we were living in.
Yeah. And just to tell you another thing of humor, of course, that church loaded us down with candy and stuff to take to their lovely pastor who was gone. And we were lugging this stuff in at 1 o'clock in the morning, getting off this plane, and a blurry-eyed guy said, "Where are you going?" And I thought, I'm going to have to open up that
before
suitcase.
Before that, you had been to Kenya before, and,
yes.
your suitcase was ravaged.
It was. I had lost everything. So I wasn't real excited about that, but however.
And you were nervous about us getting to customs.
Yeah, I really was, and I had all these things from their church members. And I went up to the man to get my passport to him. And, "Where are you going?" I said, "Oh, a little town called Mitaboni." And he said, "Mitaboni? That's my home. Go on in." Didn't even have to open a one of them. Now, talk about a God that went before us, huh? Wasn't that great? Listen, we got to stop. We're already past their time, aren't we? We'll come again.
You know, Esther and Sharon can't even begin to tell the stories. I mean, this book is full of stories, honestly, of just radical faith. They've been in situations that are terrifying from a human perspective. They've been in situations that were desperate, in situations that seemed impossible. But they've continued to put their lives in God's hands and say, we will follow where you lead us. And God has never disappointed them.
Amen.
Very, very encouraging, just a wonderful, well-written book, self-published, but really well-written, very enjoyable. So would encourage you to pick that up. I wanted to read something to you, though, because after talking with them, I was thinking about this passage that we're in, and it's the story of Joshua and Caleb. And, the part that I read today was not the end of the story for Joshua and Caleb. It was the end for the generation that refused to walk in faith. But it wasn't the end for Caleb, because God said, "I'm going to preserve Caleb and Joshua's life, and you guys will. You'll be the ones that will go in with the second generation." And this is the story of Caleb coming during the campaign for the inheritance in the second generation. This is what Caleb asked for. "The people of Judah came to Joshua at Gilgal. Caleb, the son of Jeshunah, the Kenizzite, said to him, 'You know what the Lord said to Moses, the man of God at Kadesh Barnea, concerning you and me. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land. And I brought him word again as it was in my heart. But my brothers who went up with me made the heart of the people to melt. Yet I wholly followed the Lord my God. And Moses swore on that day, saying, Surely the land on which your foot has trodden shall be an inheritance for you and for your children forever, because you have wholly followed the Lord my God. And now behold, the Lord has kept me alive, just as he has said, these 45 years since the time that the Lord spoke this word to Moses, while Israel walked in the wilderness. And now behold, I am on this day 85 years old, and I am as strong today as I was in the day that Moses sent me. My strength now is as my strength was then, for war and for going and coming. So now give me this hill country of which the Lord spoke on that day, for you heard on that day how the Anakim were there, with their great and fortified cities. It may be that the Lord will be with me, and I shall drive them out, just as the Lord said.'" That's 85-year-old Caleb. How old are you, Esther?
84 and 10 months. thank you. You're a good man. I better go sit down.
Esther, go ahead and sit down. Thank you, Esther and Sharon. Esther was 40 when God first whispered to her that she was to leave her teaching career, and has been walking with him these 45 years. So we do really have a modern-day Caleb and Joshua, and here's where I'd like to end today. First of all, I would absolutely encourage you to pick up the book, because it's just a modern-day story of two people entrusting themselves to the hand of the living God. And you know, the story for each one of us, if each one of us is to say yes to God, it won't look like their story. That's their story. But it's the same God. And he will meet us in all the circumstances in which we walk. And there's fullness of life, and there's abundance for us. But it's not automatic. God will be faithful whether we're faithful or not. But you see in this generation that we're reading about, some walked with God and some didn't. And some got to experience a bigger God and got to experience the fruit of a life of obedience, an unqualified yes. I believe that there's some in here this morning who are experiencing a desire to live more like that. You've already been living like that, but you know there's more for you. There's greater obedience. There's greater risk. There's greater attentiveness to God's voice. Greater friendship with God that would allow God to become bigger in your eyes. The question I asked as I was looking at that passage is, how did those 12 experience the very same things, and some responded with unbelief and some responded with faith? And some just were willing to consider the goodness and the greatness of God and then say, I'm going to bet my life in response to who you are. I'm going to throw in all the chips. I believe that there's some in here this morning who want more of that. So I pray this morning, you know, we don't know the plans that God has for each one of us. We just know the person that we're called to say yes to. And so if you're feeling stirred to say yes to God this morning, here's how we're going to end this morning. I'm just going to ask you to stand. The worship team is going to lead us in a last song that gives us a chance to respond. But if that's you and you want more of this, I'm going to ask you to just come down front and just fill the front, fill the aisles. And at the end of that worship song, I'm going to ask Esther to pray over us. Because in the same way that the unbelief of the 10 spies was infectious, so is faith. So is confidence in God. And I believe there's an anointing that Esther and Sharon have lived their lives with, an anointing of faith, of obedience, of risk. And I believe that can be passed along. That even as Caleb got promised that there would be descendants who would walk in the land after, who would possess the land, we get to be those spiritual descendants who would possess the land in our lives. And so if you'd like that prayer over your life this morning, just come down and after worship, after this last song, Esther's going to pray over us and commission us.
To the rock. Oh, 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 oh. declare that today. We say yes, Lord. We say yes. Let's lift it higher. Oh, we say.
Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being a heart reader. You've seen the hearts here today, Lord. And I know it's made you happy. Precious Father, there are multitudes of us that want to go on with you deeper, farther, better. Amazing things that I have seen in the last 45 years of my life. A God who never once let me down. A God who longs for his children to love him. And Father, we're here today to present our bodies, a living sacrifice, presentable to you. And you don't take lightly when our hearts are touched. We want to have them so sold out for you, Lord, that we won't have to go through even a thought of rededicating. Just add to it, Lord. We're going to stick with you. By the power of your Holy Spirit, we ask you, Lord, to keep us together in the Spirit of Jesus until we see your blessed face. And everybody in the group said, Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Now, this is not about a moment in time. It's about a lifestyle. We have some words for prayer up on the screens. There's lots of prayer needs this morning, so I know we're running a little bit late, but if we could have our ministry team stick around. If you would like prayer this morning, we'd love to pray with you, see heaven touch earth as we would just open ourselves to God's presence. Apart from that, go make the invisible God visible.